Fall down the cube tower and join us for a review of Marrakesh, a big, beautiful point salad from Stefan Feld and Queen Games, who we have to thank for providing us with a review copy.
Now, Marrakesh is part of Queen's new city series, relatively new city series, which features a number of Feld's games. This is actually game number 4 in the series and was the first game in that series that is all new. It's not a retheme or update of one of Feld's older games. This is brand new Feldness.
Now, there are currently 3 versions of this game out there. The copy we have is the Big Box Classic Edition. There is also a Deluxe Edition, which features aesthetic upgrades like different shaped playing pieces, stickers, and wooden resources. In addition, there's a newer Essential Edition, which is the same game, but in a much smaller box, with redesigned player boards, fewer components, and a lower price point to match.
Now, the important thing to note here is that all these versions, all 3 versions of Marrakesh, are the same game. They play identically. They each play 2 to 4 players, best with 3, with games taking over 2 hours on average. The physical weight of the Essential Edition may be way lower than the others, but the game weight is still the same on the medium-heavy side of things.
Now, Queen and the Board Game Geek community agree that this game is best for gamers 14+, and that seems about right to us too, though we're sure some younger kids could dig it, especially if they're already used to Feld's style of games. While a lot is going on in Marrakesh, the actual game mechanics aren't overly complicated.
So in Marrakesh, players are competing to be the most influential family in the city through the use of assistants and resources represented by wooden cylinders called keshis. The game is played over only 3 seasons, each of which has 4 rounds. Each round, players secretly select 3 actions, each represented by a different colored keshi. The strength of each action is based on how many keshis the player has already collected, and those keshis are collected from one of Feld's famous cube towers, so you never know exactly what you'll get. In a typical Stefan Feld fashion, each of these different actions will give you points for doing different things. In Marrakesh, you will explore the desert, harvest figs, go fishing, progress up mosque and palace tracks, use scholars to draft scrolls, and more.
Now check out our Marrakesh unboxing video on YouTube to see the ridiculous amount of stuff you get in this box. It is a ton of wood, cardboard, dual-layer boards, and more.
The component quality in Marrakesh is good to excellent. The wooden components are great. The fact the keshis are octagonal means they won't roll away, which is a nice bonus. Dual-layer boards are great for holding everything and so far haven't warped. The amount of cardboard really is staggering, and the rulebook is fantastic. There is a ton going on here, but the rulebook is actually broken up and color-coded by section, which makes each action type easy to find and makes the book surprisingly good for reference.
You know, some things that could be improved are the rather tiny, easy-to-lose gate tokens. Which in the deluxe version are actual wooden gates, but not in the big box or essential.
Yeah.
And then the tiny player screens with their almost useless iconography. To be honest, iconography overall could be a little bit better. Now, once you've played 4 or 5 times, you may start recognizing everything. But until then, keep that reference book handy.
Yeah, and that's a good thing to call out. The reference book or appendix book that's almost as thick as the rule book is great because it explains every tile, every reward spot, every icon, every scroll, every trade transaction, end game scoring, everything is all in there in detail, and you're going to use that book a lot.
Now, one thing that needs to be called out is how much room all of this stuff takes up on the table. This is one of the biggest table hogs we've ever seen. We could barely fit 3 of us at Mo's dining room table, which can seat 6 at a meal, but has no chance of fitting 4 players for this game.
Yeah, even once we got access to my game room again, it was rough getting the game to fit in a 4x6 area because the main board with a player board at each end doesn't fit. It's more than 4 feet wide. And we had to put our player boards beside the main board even to be able to fit. Just put it this way, the fact they released a smaller Essential Edition does not surprise me at all. I think it was a good decision.
Okay, so pretty much every review, we warn you, that we're only giving you a high-level overview of play, but that is true more than ever tonight. Marrakesh has a lot going on, and there's no way we can cover the entire game in detail tonight.
So setup in Marrakesh takes a bit and involves a lot of sorting of things and placing things into bags and pulling them out and randomizing things and putting stuff on the main boards and the individual player boards. But all you really need to know if the game's for you is for a gist of what's going on, is that everyone is going to start with 12 cashies behind their screen, one in each color, and they're going to have three assistants who are their workers.
Marrakesh is played over three seasons with four rounds each. Each round has four phases. The first round has players select cashies and deploy assistants. Simultaneously, everyone selects three cashies from behind their screen, representing the actions that they would like to do this turn. Once everyone has picked, they are revealed, and players place one assistant on the appropriate action spot on their player board for each action. Note that red water vendor cashies are wild and allow you to place that assistant anywhere.
The next phase has players claim cashies and deploying them. All of the cashies chosen this round by all the players are gathered and thrown into the cube tower. The ones that come out are sorted, and then players are going to draft them by color, taking at most two at a time. Each cashie drafted is placed onto the player's player board. Now, some cashies, the pink entertainers, the brown caravans, and the green date pickers, do give a bonus one place, so don't miss that.
The next phase is the bulk of the game and has players using their assistants. Each player will activate all three of their assistants before play moves on to the next player. I point this out because we got it wrong the first couple of games.
Yep.
When activating an assistant, you can either do that region's action or you can collect one keshi of the appropriate color. The strength of the various actions is based on how many keshis the player has already collected in that region or color.
Okay, so green date picker keshis let you collect dates, one for each keshi you have. Blue fish keshis move your fishermen up a river track, which give you increasingly better end of round bonuses, as well as the potential for end of season rewards.
Purple, yellow, and orange keshis represent goods, carpets, lamps, and spices that can be traded at the souk for resources or luxury goods.
Pink entertainers activate the main square and have players rotate their audience disc by one spot, then pick one reward where they already have a keshi. They get the reward shown, multiplied by the number of people watching shown on the disc.
Now, black cleric keshis and white noble keshis go to the mosque and palace, respectively, and each moves the player's markers up on the respective tracks. After crossing certain threshold lines on these tracks, players earned money and other bonuses.
Gray scholar keshis go to the madrasa, where they craft scrolls. Here, keshis are more of a currency that can be spent to acquire powerful rule-breaking abilities at the cost of dates.
Beige guards are played to the medina. Here, players will buy gates for money, which they will pair with a guard. Each gate gives a bonus keshi in its color, and they can earn or cost the player points. Gates which are built matching the color of the area they protect earn bonus points.
Brown caravans are used to explore the Sahara and unlock endgame scoring opportunities. At the end of the game, you're going to score your three best oases.
The red water vendor keshis can be placed at any of the other areas we just described. When you activate an area with a water vendor, you earn one water in addition to the keshi or action taken.
Now, at the end of each round, players get a bonus based on where their fishermen are located. At the end of each season, players also need to provide for their people. At the start of the game, each player gets three provision tiles. They flip one of these up per round, and each round they have to fulfill the requirements of all of the face-up tiles, or else lose a significant number of points and, possibly more importantly, all of their resources.
At the end of each season, final river rewards are handed out. At the start of each season, the turn order shifts and each player gets a fresh set of 12 different keshis to put behind their screens.
After the final season, players are awarded bonus points for each completely filled section on their player board, which requires 8 keshis and 1 water vendor. They get points for their best 3 oases, as mentioned, and a minor amount of points for any leftover resources. Player with the most points wins.
There, simple, right? Basically just 12 terms of putting some stuff on a board, right? Easy.
Oh, yeah. Now, the big thing with Marrakesh is that while that may sound extremely overwhelming, and trust me, it intimidated it for me at first. The game stayed on my shelf of shame a little longer than it should have, because I was intimidated by this. There are only actually 9 possible actions in the game, and most of those are very simple.
One of the things that makes this game so very intimidating is the graphic design. There is a lot of color here, and while it makes sense and helps gameplay to someone familiar, it's incredibly overwhelming to try and figure out what it all means and a bit of sensory overload on initial setup.
Now, to keep things simple going forward, I'm going to talk about things by Keshi color. So, an example of the action simplicity here. The blue, black, and white Keshis have you move up on tracks. That's it. You just, the number of Keshis, you move up that many spots. Green Keshis give you food. Super simple. Number of Keshis, you take that much food. The market actions are also easy, as your orange, yellow, and purple Keshis just represent goods to be traded in. Pink isn't too bad either. Turn the disc on your board and get a reward. The other three that are a little harder and do trip people up.
And again, they aren't hard taken on their own. Each individual action is thematic and graphically well shown. Blue is fishing, white and black are the white and black stairways. It's pretty obvious individually.
Yep. Now that said, there are of course a lot of moving parts here and lots of little tiny rules that are easy to miss. Our first 3 games, we had the turn order completely wrong. For whatever reason, I had it stuck in my head that everyone would take one action with one assistant, then move to the next player. And then they would take an action with an assistant and then move to the next player instead of completing all 3 assistant actions in once in the order you choose. And that surprisingly changes the game quite a bit. And then even after 4 plays, we missed a rule where you could spend 1 dinar, the coins in the game, to rotate the scrolls before purchasing them when taking a gray Keshi action.
Though to be fair, the rotating scrolls action is rather high-level action that requires you to know the scrolls and be willing to gamble, which requires a certain level of component knowledge. To be honest, it's probably not an action that I can even imagine myself taking without playing this game many more times, while D, I suspect, might have actually used it in our last game.
Yeah, I remember one point in the last game where everything that was up on the worst scrolls was like no one wanted them. So I could even see doing it even not knowing what's there. Just what's there is no use to me and I got to take something. So may as well look what else there is. Now, one of the reasons I called out that I've been calling the Keshis by color is I wanted to point out that the theme here really doesn't matter all that much. This is typical of Stefan Feld's games and Marrakesh is no exception. It fits that pasted on theme thing that Feld's kind of known for. So far, no one I played with has said, you know, pass me a date picker or I'm going to take a caravan action. It's always give me a green Keshi, please, or I'm moving in the desert, or pass me a purple and 2 yellows. There's also not really a lot of thematic tie-in anywhere else either. Though I would say the lack of theme isn't a problem. It doesn't get in the way. It doesn't bother me. There's nothing wrong. It doesn't cause any problems. But similar to Sean's thoughts on Lords of Waterdeep, you're just calling them colored Keshis and cubes and points.
Now, that said, you could talk about date pickers and water vendors. It's not that the theme isn't there and isn't actually interesting. Now, I can't comment on accurate, but it is an interesting look at a historical experience in the Imperial Moroccan city.
Now, one of the biggest problems we have with Marrakesh is that a big problem, how dang big the game is. It takes up a lot of room and has a ton of little tiny pieces. This size means you need a big table, and the amount of small tiny bits here has me not wanting to bring the game out public play events because it'd be really easy to lose some of these small pieces. And they don't give you any extras here. There's no spare Keshis, there's no spare gates. While I do dig the components in the game, and I gotta admit, I like the nice big player board and the fact you're gonna put multiple Keshis on it, and I love the way it looks, I can totally see the appeal of the Essential Edition with its tracks versus individual spots.
In fact, we've already misplaced a non-essential but frustrating component of the cube tower that keeps the cubes from skittering away. And it's actually a larger piece than the frustratingly tiny gates that we have mentioned a couple of times now. The sound of a Keshi hitting the floor in this game is frankly terror-inducing because of the limited number of pieces and the fact that the counts and things matter.
Yes. Yeah, everything is actually limited by the number of components. And the same problem is every time we pull out the gates, I'm always worried one's going to be missing. Like, I'm always the last pull to fill the last market. I'm always like, is there enough gates? Is there enough gates? Good, there were eight. Okay. We still have all the gates. Thank gosh. Overall, I really love this game. I would go so far to say I'm a bit of a Feld fanboy, and Marrakesh scratches all of my Feld itches. To me, this is one of his best games to date, and it's wonderfully varied point salad. And I feel like I'm still discovering this game even after multiple plays. Every game is played differently, and it feels like I'm only scratching the surface. I'm learning how to play the game good.
So on the other hand, while I can appreciate the game, I don't mind playing it at all. It's a sort of brain burn that I'm not actively seeking out in games. I see the appeal. I've had fun playing it several times now, but I don't completely share in that feeling, and I don't feel the pull to play it at the sort of level that Mo and Dee do.
Yeah, because, well, speaking of Deanna, while I'm a big Feld fan, Bellhop behind the scenes mystic Deanna is even more so. Her favorite game of all time was Trajan. And I say was because, as far as we can tell, it's been replaced by Marrakesh. So she's still really pushing to have a game night where we play one after each other just to see if perhaps the Trajan may still win out. So far, she thinks this may be the best Feld has to offer. Now, she loves heavy, thinky games with lots of options and decision points, and Marrakesh delivers on that count without getting too heavy. Right? This doesn't get to the point where some heavy Euro games get, where it feels like work and you're totally exhausted by the end when you're done playing. It doesn't quite get that far.
Now, for me, if I tried to take it to the level that D is playing at, it would feel like work and probably burn me out. Now, I actually feel pretty good about my showing. Even coming in last both times, the real difference in that final scoring displays clearly the extra work the D puts into understanding the interactions of the various aspects, maximizing scoring paths, and finding her proper path and matching up the right tiles to buy from the markets to the way she is playing that game. It's remarkable to watch, and her score definitely shows that effort she's put into it.
So if you're a fan of Stefan Feld's point salad style games, stuff on the heavier side like Amerigo and Trajan, you need to do yourself a favor and find a way to try Marrakesh. If you're half the Feld fan that my wife and I are, you can probably skip trying it and just go pick up a copy. Just be aware how much space the classic and deluxe editions take up and purchase appropriately. You may be better off with the essential edition.
Indeed, I would say that for most people, the essential is probably enough. But for the real fan that has the space, the big box and the deluxe versions are a delight.
Now, I'm pretty sure you knew this when we said Feld at the start of this review, but light game fans, party game fans, beer and pretzel gamers, family night gamers will probably want to avoid this one. Well, it's not the heaviest game out there. There is definitely stuff that's more brain burny, and you're not going to want to break out Excel on your final turn to plan out everything else. This is a meaty mechanics mashup that's probably not going to appeal to lighter audiences.
That said, if you are the light gamer in your group, much like I am, if you're not worried about winning, you can still actually have a great experience playing this game. Just know that the real Feld fans will trounce you in the final score. But if that's okay, just playing through the game is an interesting, fun experience.
Now, Marrakesh is the first game we've actually tried in Queen Games' New City series, and I am looking forward to more. I've got Hamburg on our pile of shame and obligation, and I am really looking forward to checking that one out, as well as other games in the series. If they're even half as good as Marrakesh, we're in for a treat.
Now, are you a Feld fan or Feld fanatic like Bo and Dee? What's your favorite Stefan Feld game? Is it from the New City series? What Feld game should we try and get our hands on next? Let us know in the comments down below.